This is my song. Pieces of the Lord so that we have them with us all week long. I'm going to read out of 1 Corinthians 11:23 through 27 says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had broken, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord." Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for all the blessings in our lives. We're so looking forward to when you come back and when we can be with you, Lord. I ask today, as I walk through this, I ask that if there is anything that you see in me that is unpleasing to you, Lord, I ask for forgiveness for that. I ask for forgiveness for the angry thoughts and all of the stuff that goes inside my head. Help us all to focus on you, and when we come to your table to break bread with you, Lord, I ask that you just help us to be as pure as we can on this side. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may take the elements.
Supplies, Lord. God, I pray that you'll provide every need that they need right now. I pray that you'll comfort them through the loss, Lord. God, we pray for those that have lost loved ones this week. I just pray, God, right now that you'll comfort them. Wrap your arms around them to know that you love them. You are mourning with them, Lord. God, we pray those that are battling confusion and frustration and fear, Lord. Bring them clarity. Bring them peace. God, those that are battling illnesses or diseases right now, Lord, or those that are still waiting on test results, we pray, God, that you'll heal, that you'll bring comfort, that you'll bring direction to the doctors, Lord. God, we pray for those that are affected by the wildfires around us. We pray, God, that you'll calm the winds, that you'll bring the rain, that you'll extinguish those fires, Lord. God, we pray that you'll be our peace in the midst of chaos, that you'll be our guide in the midst of the confusion, that you'll be our comforter in the midst of mourning. So God, we place our trust in you because you never fail, that you are the one that brings the answers. So I pray that we take that time just to listen to you, that we seek your direction in everything that we're going through. Jesus. Amen. Good morning. I'm Pastor Mark. I'm the prayer pastor here at Living Water. You notice on your seats there's these connection cards. I really encourage you to fill those out. On the back, there's a place for prayer requests and praises. We have an amazing prayer team here at Living Water that prays for those throughout the week. Love to just intercede and stand with our family. You are our family. Amen.
So we're going to move into a time of tithe and offering. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. This is another way that we are able to worship Jesus. We're able to worship with our treasure here at Living Water. There are many different ways to give. You can give through the app, online, through text message. There's a little black box up there where you got your communion from. And then we'll have the ushers come around in a minute. I'm going to pray now. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us all these different ways that we can worship you. I ask that as each person gives today, that you bless them tenfold. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys can go around. While the ushers are coming around, I'd like you to direct your attention to the screens for our announcements.
Good morning! Jesus looks amazing on you in this sweater weather, Living Water!
Sweater weather.
Just give me some volunteers!
Woo! Yay!
Just give me some volunteers!
Yay!
Come see the man, change the ministry!
Yay! And we need volunteers in the cafe, welcome center, youth ministry. If you're interested in volunteering at all, be sure to stop at our welcome center after service and be the church.
Woo! And while you're at it, make sure you take out your cell phones, your tablets, your iPads to download the app for Living Water Cheyenne. And all you Android users out there, woohoo, is on the Google Play Store. So be sure and download to stay connected with all things Living Water.
Yes. And Women's Conference, October 19th. You are not going to want to miss it. That is only like 2 weeks away, Ox.
It's coming up.
So we need you to get registered for October 19th, Women's Conference. There's going to be amazing speakers, amazing fellowship, amazing lives being changed, and you're not going to want to miss it. So come worship, come praise, and be a part of this year's Women's Conference.
It sounds very exciting. Woo! I'm super excited. Woohoo! And then all you youth out there, we are meeting the first and third Sunday this month, so don't forget to mark that down. The first and third Sunday of the month, youth is meeting with Billy.
Hi.
And Living Water, you know that a praying church is a powerful church, so you don't want to miss Monday night prayer night this Monday, tomorrow, at Pastor Jason's house from 6 to 7. It's a come and go as you need. No requirements or anything. So it's just a time to be in prayer, pray about anything that you feel on your heart, and it's super, super powerful. So make sure you be there on Monday night at Pastor Jason's house, 6 to 7.
And one thing we definitely need to be in prayer for is our legacy fund, because we are always searching for a permanent home for Living Water. What does legacy mean? It means a long-lasting impact. And how can you make an impact, you're wondering? You can easily go to our app under the Give, scroll down to Legacy Fund, and you will be able to donate any monetary amount that you want to give to that Legacy Fund. Might be wondering what stands in our legacy fund right now. $61,958.02. So if God has put on your heart to be a part of that long-lasting impact, please donate to our legacy fund. Hey Ox, what's a tree's favorite song in autumn?
I don't know. What?
Don't stop believing.
And we believe in you, Living Water.
Have a great week.
Bye.
We love you.
Well, good morning, Living Water.
Good morning.
It's good to be in God's house today.
Yes,
man.
Sir.
So listen, I want to add just one more announcement to the announcements. All three ladies did a fantastic job. Even the cameraman did a great job as well. Hey, listen, gentlemen, put it on your calendars, October 25th. It's a Friday. Say October 25th, man.
October 25th.
Yeah, you say it from the diaphragm, okay? Yeah. October 25th, say it.
October
25th. Is my mic not on? My mic is on. She came over here and snapped at me. Did you see that? No, she ate it. All right, so Friday, October 25th. Men, we are going to launch our first men's ministry. It's going to be from 6 to 7:30 that night. And our leaders, I'm going to have them stand up. I'm going to have Brian and Aaron and Dan, if you just stand up where you are. Brian's over here. Where's Dan? There they are. These are going to be the men who are going to lead us on that Friday. So make sure that you put it on your calendar. And also, we have a sign up right over here at the Welcome Center, so make sure that you sign up today, all the way up until that time. And so we're just going to get together. We're going to launch it. We have some amazing ideas, and so we didn't want all the women to have all the fun, so we're taking over and going to it. So remember, October 25th, it's a Friday night from 6 to 7:30, and we're excited to be able to kick that off. Well, listen, if you are in the grades of 7th through 12th, this is the time that we're going to ask you to follow Billy on out the door. He's got something geared up and planned for you guys. And so, we want you to know that we love you, we see you. Look at all these kids walking out there. Hallelujah, so awesome. I want to cheer for them all the time because we want them to know that we got their back. Amen.
Yeah.
Let's jump into God's word today, as we are going to be focusing on Acts chapter 12. That's where we're going to camp out today. So Acts chapter 12, we're going to be tackling verses 1 through 16. And as you're doing that, turn to your neighbor, look them deep in the eye, and say, Jesus looks good on you.
Jesus looks good on you.
Thank you. So Acts chapter 12, that's where we're going to be today. Acts chapter 12. If you've got it, say amen.
Amen.
If you need a minute, say, give me a minute. Wonderful. Let's stand as we read God's word. That's what we do to honor his word and to honor him, as we stand in honor of that. So Acts chapter 12, starting in verse 1. About that time, King Herod violently attacked some who belonged to the church, and he executed James, John's brother, with a sword. When he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter too during the festival of unleavened bread. After the arrest, he put him in prison and assigned four squads of four soldiers, each to guard him, intending to bring him out to the people after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was praying fervently to God for him. When Herod was about to bring him out for trial, that very night Peter, bound with two chains, was sleeping between two soldiers, while the sentries in front of the door guarded the prison. Suddenly, say suddenly.
Suddenly.
Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. Striking Peter on the side, he woke him up and said, "Quick, get up." And the chains fell off his wrists. "Get dressed," the angel told him, "and put on your sandals." And he did. "Wrap your cloak around you," he told him, "and follow me." So he went out and followed, and he did not know that what the angel did was really happening, but he thought he was seeing a vision. After they passed the first and second guards, they came to the iron gates that led to the city, which opened to them by itself. They went outside and passed one street, and suddenly the angel left him. When Peter came to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's grasp and from all the Jewish people expected." As soon as he realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John Mark, where many had assembled and were praying. He knocked at the door of the outer gate, and a servant named Rhoda came to answer. She recognized Peter's voice, and because of her joy, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter was standing at the outer gate. "You're out of your mind," they told her, but she kept insisting that it was true, and they said, "It's his angel." Peter, however, kept knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were amazed. Yeah. Heavenly Father, we sure do love you. We thank you, God, for your word. We thank you, God, for your time. We thank you, God, for the opportunity to worship you. Because, God, we trust in you and you alone. And I thank you, God, for what you're about to do. I pray, Father, that as we speak right now, chains break in Jesus' name. Father, I pray, God, that freedom is found in this place. So, Holy Spirit, move in us. I don't even have to invite you here because you're already here. And so, Father, I pray that in these next moments that you would open our eyes so that we can see your word more clearly. And, Father, and I pray that you open up our ears so we can hear your word more clearly. And, Father, and I pray you open up our hearts so we can feel your word more clearly. God, we're excited about what you're going to do, so come do it in us now. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you have a seat, turn to three people and say, "A praying church is a powerful church."
A praying church is a powerful church.
Let me ask you this question. Do you believe in the power of prayer?
Yes, sir. Yes.
And when you pray, do you pray expectantly?
Yes.
Here's the thing. What I love about Living Water, we are a praying church first. That's what I love about it. In this place, in Living Water, prayer is a priority. When we were launching Living Water, our launch team was meeting together. And what was happening was we were getting really close to the weekly launch that we were going to do. So we're doing monthly. And so what was happening was we were carrying a lot of this equipment, and like 2 to 3 trucks would come to my house, and we would throw everything in the back of those trucks and bring them here. And we were like, we need a trailer. That's what we need. And we went out looking for trailers, and we put bids on trailers, and we were always outbid. So we sat down as a team, as a launch team, every Thursday night, and we started praying. And we said, God, we need a trailer. So will you provide us with a trailer, right? We spent the whole hour just praying. The next day, someone bought us a trailer. How cool is that? Right? Then we're a month away from our weekly in September when we were going to go live, what I call it, live. And we needed $10,000 just to make things happen for us. And so I sat on the front porch and I said, God, we need $10,000. I don't even know how to do it. And we need it by the end of this month. And so I just started praying, asking God, Lord, can you help us? And so he put five men on my heart. And he says, here's what I want you to do. I don't want you to call him. I don't even want you to email him. I don't even want you to send a letter. What I want you to do is I want you to text them, tell them what you need. And we just launched our PushPay, our giving online. And he says, I want you to give them that and tell them why you need it for. And so I texted, right? Who doesn't? I text, hey, man, can you help us out financially? Here's a text, right? And I texted it to him, right? When I texted all those five men, in 2 hours, God gave us $10,000, right? How cool is that, right? So listen, here's the thing. When you pray expectantly, okay? And you believe in the power of prayer. I want you to know that before you all come in here, every seat in here is prayed for. That when you come here, this building, I march around this building and I pray for this building. I want you to know that even after service, people are praying over people. That's what I love. I love seeing people praying over people. And every first Monday, say first Monday. Every first Monday of the month, we, the church, we gather at Monica Trudy's house and we pray. Because I believe that prayer changes everything. So here's the thing, right? So when Trudy and I were growing up, we met in junior high. Now back at that time, a long time ago, someone said, were you born in the 30s today? I told them it was the 20s. I was born in the 70s, okay? So here's the thing. I met Trudy in junior high, and in high school, we didn't have cell phones. But we were always on the phone. There's a thing at home where you had a landline, and it was mounted on the wall or on the cabinet, and you had this long cord and all that stuff. And as teenagers, we were talking on the phone all the time. And I would always talk to Trudy late at night because that's what teenagers do. And during that time, you would actually dedicate songs to each other, right? And so, well, it's going to be on the radio. You got to listen to it. And, you know, you play these songs and all that good stuff. Well, as you're talking late at night, my mom and dad would get on the phone, or my mom or dad would get on the phone and say, hey, man, it's time for us to get off the phone. You're being too loud. Yada, yada, yada. So we're like, okay. But then this happens when it's time to get off the phone. Hey, man, I got to go. You heard my parents. You know, they kind of embarrassed me a little bit. I just got to go. And so I said, I'm not going to hang up until you hang up. And she says, no, you hang up first. Oh, no, girl. I'm not going to hang up. And for like 5 minutes, we're like, no, you hang up. You hang up, right? Then my dad gets on. No, you both hang up. This is how it worked, right? But here's the thing. When prayer is the same thing as talking on the phone. But listen, the person on the other line is our Heavenly Father. Right? He's the creator of the heaven and earth. He's the Alpha and Omega. And when you call, you're not going to get a busy signal. I'm sorry, your call cannot be completed as dialed. Please hang up and try your call again. It doesn't say that. But here's the thing. God is always waiting to listen. He's always wanting to hear from you. And because of that, prayer is super powerful. And when we're talking to Jesus, we should be saying, no, you hang up. And he's going to be like, no, you hang up. Right? And we should be having those kind of conversations. Turn to your neighbor and say, prayer is powerful.
Prayer is powerful.
So in Acts chapter 2, we see that King Herod has blood on his hands. Right? He's already put James to death by beheading him, and this is actually pleasing the crowd. And because it pleases the crowd, he arrests others, and he arrests Peter, and he grabs him and he throws him in jail. And so he's not going to execute him right away, but he decides, I'm going to wait until after this festival of this unleavened bread. And what he's hoping for is if he executes Peter. He's hoping he's going to get more likes on his page because he's going to be able to execute him, right? They were excited. We got James. That's one of the Jesus' disciples. Now we got Peter. We got one of the leaders, right? And so they're super pumped. It's nighttime, and Peter is heavily guarded and chained to some guards. Listen to this. I'm talking about prayer, but we're going to see a situation first. Let's put it up on the screen. Here it is, right? It says this. It says, after the arrest, he put him in prison, and he assigned four squads of four soldiers, each to guard him. We're talking about Peter. Intending to bring him out to the people after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was what?
Praying
fervently to God for him. When Herod was about to bring him out for trial, that very night, Peter, bound with two chains, was what?
Sleeping
between two soldiers, while sentries in front of the door guarded the prison. What's the church doing at this moment?
Praying.
What is Peter doing at the moment?
Sleeping.
Peter finds himself in a tough and a rough situation. He's bound by two chains like an animal. Not just one chain, but he's bound by two chains, okay? He is surrounded by four squads of four soldiers. He has 16 soldiers surrounding him, making sure that he doesn't escape and making sure that no one comes in to steal him. Not only that, he is double chained and he's sleeping between two soldiers. Now the number's up to 18. They got 18 dudes watching over Peter. I don't think that King Herod is worried about his life. I think King Herod is worried about his prisoner escaping because he's one of Jesus' boys. Okay? Listen, King Herod knows that Jesus died and now the tomb is empty. What's going to happen to Peter? We're going to surround him. 18 soldiers are surrounded there. Wait, it gets better, okay? There are sentries, okay, that are guarding the door of the prisons. I'm not sure how many there were. They said sentries, not century, right? So there's more than one, okay? So I'm going to say that there's about 30 soldiers. And these sentries here, their responsibility is to keep guard of the control access to the place. He's got 18 soldiers in the prison with him. The first access door to the jail, there are sentries there. A couple other heavy armed dudes. Another place, another access point, more sentries. You cannot get in and you cannot get out, right? And they have this place surrounded. I'm pretty sure it's better than Secret Service right now. Did I go too far? Okay. So would you say that Peter is heavily guarded?
Yes.
Okay. So he is surrounded by King Herod's soldiers, the best of the best when it comes to these soldiers. There's no way out. His situation looks bleak, and death is certain. What is the church doing?
Praying.
And what is Peter doing?
Sleeping.
Peter is sleeping during this whole process, surrounded by dudes, and he's going to die. And the church is praying fervently. If I look at the word fervently, it means passionately or seriously or energetically. The church was basically on the phone with God nonstop. And they're saying, as Heavenly Father, we just come to you right now, Lord, and we ask, Lord, that you would be with Peter. Father, we ask, God, that you would be in that cell place with him, Lord. We ask that you would comfort him. We pray, God, that you would set him free, because we know, Lord, God, that there is he's not done yet. You've got plans for him. So, Father, we pray that you intervene. Father, we pray you send an angel. Father, we pray you break him out. Father, we pray you open Herod's eyes. Father, we just pray that you would step in and intervene. And this is the church.
praying in place and passionately for Peter. They're saying, Father, please, we're asking that you just step in. Maybe there's some of us right now in this room that we feel like we're tied up and that we are bound to our situations like Peter, or maybe our circumstances, or maybe we're tied up to our struggles or our addictions, or maybe it's our illnesses, or maybe it's the way that we feel about ourselves. We feel like we're surrounded, and we feel like there's no way out of them. We feel stuck. We feel exhausted, that we can't see the light at the end of the tunnel. We feel hopeless, and we're just saying, Lord, I need you to rescue me. Right? You find yourself in the middle of the storm, and you feel exhausted. Anybody? Am I talking to anybody? Yeah. Just saying, man, this is where I'm at. This is where I'm struggling right now. Jason, you don't even know the beginning of it, of what's going on in me. But on the outside, I just play it cool. But on the inside, I'm like a duck's feet in the water. I'm just like this. I'm just exhausted. I need the Lord to rise up. In 2008, I have a brother, he's 2 years younger than me. My brother got in a serious car accident. In fact, what happened was he was on a two-lane highway, and he's coming home from work. And this truck carrying a trailer, it's a 3500 Dodge, I think it was, carrying a trailer, just cut in front of Chad, going 55 miles an hour. My brother, he just got in front of him. My brother ran into him, and a UPS in my truck sandwiched my brother right behind him. The only safe spot was the driver's seat. So if his family was in the car, my brother would have lost his entire family. I saved safe spot, but my brother's knees were rammed into the dashboard, and he jacked up his knees, he broke his back, he broke his neck. It was horrible. It was a horrible accident, but he made it, right? His body is broken. He can't walk. He's struggling. Can't even stand up. Like his back is bad, right? During this process, so this happened like in May or June. Well, our father, my dad, our dad passed away in that September. And so my brother, because of his health, he also lost his job. So my brother at that moment in 2018 was a country song, right? So he lost his health. He lost his job. He lost his dad. He lost his home. He lost his wealth, right? He had nothing but his family. Right? I told Chad I was going to say that. He's cool with it. He lost everything, right? He's got three boys, and he lost everything. He's the only provider of his family. And so he lost everything, and he had to move in with my mom. He moved here. He lives in Longmont. He moved here. His body is broken. The doctor said, Chad, you will probably have 5 years of hard labor. You see, my brother was a guy who worked on the docks. So when the semi trucks would come in, he would unload it and load it, and he would do all that stuff. And that's what he did. He's just a hard worker. And so they said, you probably got 5 years, right? And so he was going through the legal process. They promised him millions of dollars to help him with this. And for a whole year, he struggled with this. He laid at my mom's couch. He couldn't move. He couldn't do anything. He's just really struggling. Can't keep a job. None of that stuff. By the time it was all said and done, the legal people, in my opinion, failed him because they could only get him $20,000.
Yes.
So he had enough. And he took that $20,000 that he got from the accident, and he moved his entire family to Longmont. There, he got a job at Celestial Tea, making $10.25 an hour. And so here he is, he's working hard. He's got to wear these knee braces, right? So he's got these knee braces that he puts on. And if you take those knee braces off, he can't walk. But he has to have these knee braces on just to keep him up, okay? At that time, he was probably 33 years old when that accident happened. They told him he was too young to get knee replacement surgery. He's like 49 now, so I was like, dude, get him out, right? Just do it. So here he is, he's got these knee braces on, and he's having this conversation like, I can't support my family at $10.25 an hour. So he said, Father, I need you to give me a raise up to $18. Otherwise, I gotta leave, I gotta go somewhere. The following week, Celestial Tea said, Chad, we want to bump your pay, and gave him $18 an hour. Right, so God answered with that. 1 year later, they promoted him to supervisor, and now he was making over $54,000 a year. So this is actually an increase. Listen to me. He lost his job in 2008. This is actually an increase of $2,000 more a year than he was making at Celestial Tea than he was making at the place that he was, right? Now, he's still working. Body's still beat up. Body's still broken, right? So then another company called him up and said, hey, Chad, we want you to come and run the night shift. And so in January, he was just recently promoted to plant manager, is now making over six figures a year. Listen to this. For 16 years, he did hard labor with a broken body, but he prayed fervently to the Lord, and he put his trust in the Lord, and he works his tail off as if he's working for the Lord. And listen, if you do your part, God's going to do his part. So prayer is a powerful tool, right? Prayer is not a magic wand. Prayer is not just something that's like, beep, you got a blue dress. Beep, your check account is huge. Beep, you got the new car. Beep, you have new hair. It just doesn't work that way, right? But here's the thing. Prayer is a powerful tool, and it moves heaven's army into position on your behalf. So whatever situation you're in, or whatever circumstance you're in, or whatever storm you're in, call out to him. Call on some prayer warriors and have them join you in this battle. That's what the church is here for. Look around you. This is your family. So let them walk this journey with you. You just heard me say that I love seeing people praying over people here because I believe that prayer is powerful. Say, prayer is powerful. So if the Lord puts something or someone on your mind, listen to me, if the Lord puts someone on your mind, you should call them up or go to them and pray for them, right? Now, if they say, I don't want you to pray for me, you say, okay. And then you turn around and you pray out loud anyways. Okay? Nobody can stop you from praying. Okay? So pray for them. Say a praying church is a powerful church. So verse 7 says this. It says, suddenly, say suddenly.
Suddenly.
Suddenly, angel of the Lord appeared and a light shone in the cell. Striking Peter on the side, he woke him up and he said, quick! Get up! And the chains fell off of his wrist. Get dressed, the angel told him, and put on your sandals. And he did. Wrap your cloak around you, he told him, and follow me. He's giving him instructions. So he went out and followed, and he did not know what the angel did was really happening, but he thought he was seeing a vision. After they passed the first and second guards, they came to the iron gate that leads into the city, which opened to them by itself, and they went outside and passed one street, and suddenly the angel left him. The church is what?
Praying
how? The church is praying fervently for Peter. Lord, please show up and rescue him. Save him. And the Lord heard him, and he said, all right, I'm going to send an angel. Just one. He just needs one angel. He didn't send the Navy SEAL angels. He sent one angel. One angel is enough. And he shows up to Peter's heavily guarded, chained up situation. And Peter is what?
Sleeping.
He's sleeping. He's like in a deep sleep. He's about to be killed in the morning, but he's sleeping. I'm talking like drool coming out of the side of his face kind of sleep. I'm talking about he's snoring so bad that when he's sleeping between two soldiers, the soldiers are rolling him over so he'll stop snoring. At least that's what my wife does to me. She says. Right, so I believe he's sleeping like that. And listen to what he says. I'm glad, let's keep this up there. Listen to this. And at the angel's words, he said, quick, get up. Right, he poked him on the side. Hey, I'm an angel. And he says, quick, get up. And at the sound of his voice, the chains, he's doubly chained, fall off of him. The church is praying, right? Fall off of him. And then he says, as soon as he says, get up, he says, and the chains fall off, he says, hey, get dressed and put on your shoes and grab your coat. See, he's in a situation, in his situation, Peter is at peace because he knows God's got a plan. I'm just resting. And the church was praying passionately. So here's the thing. The angel walks him over the two guards that he was between. Not like this, quietly. He just walked him out. Right? Four squads of four, so there's 16. Pass those dudes. He's like, come on, Peter, what are you doing? Are you hungry? I'm kind of hungry. hungry, right? And that's what the angel's saying. And Peter's just like in the days. Nobody hears anything. He goes by the sentries, right? They're guarding the first access. Nobody's going to get it. He walks past them, right? Then he walks back the first one. And nobody sees anything. Nobody hears anything. And he's just walking past these 30-some-odd soldiers. They didn't see a thing. And then they walk down the street. They get to the city gate. And the city gate opens up for them. They didn't open it. The city gate was open for them. Right. Listen, when the church prays, heaven moves. And God sent an angel and freed Peter and took him out of the city, and he opened the gate for him. It says that he walked maybe a block and the angel left. Gone. By himself. Peter is by himself. And the church is constantly praying, and he's moving in this situation. Listen to this. The disciples find themselves in another situation in Mark chapter 4. And I wonder if Peter thought of this. It says, on that day when evening had come, he told them, let's cross over to the other side of the sea. So they left the crowd and took him along since he was in the boat. Where's Jesus? In the boat, and other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking over the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. It's about to go down. Jesus, he was in the stern, and what is he doing?
Sleeping.
He's sleeping on the cushion. So they woke him up and said, teacher, don't you care that we are going to die? Jesus got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, silence. Be still. The wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Then he said to them, why are you afraid? You still have no faith? And they were terrified and asked one another, who is this? Even the wind and the sea obey him. I want you to know, listen to me, God knows your situation, and he sees the storms that you are in, because he is actually in the storm with you. And your storms that you are in right now, your situations that you're in right now, I want you to know that they have to bow down to Jesus. Because right now, I believe in this very room, those under the sound of my voice, I believe that right now, chains are being broken in your life right now. I believe that you're breathing in his healing, and I believe you're healing physically and mentally and spiritually right now. Why? Because even the wind and the sea have to obey him. Jesus is in your boat. And if he's at peace in your storm, then we should be at peace in our storm. There's another story that we find in 1 Kings. I love the prophet Elijah. He's my dude. Right? And here he is. I'm going to show you a prayer real quick. But let me set the scene. So Elijah is battling 450 prophets of Baal, right? And here they are, and they are setting up, they're having like a competition or something. And so they're setting up two altars, right? And they got this this bull, and like a bull, like a calf. And they cut it up, and they made an idol out of it, right? So like an altar, right? And they said, okay, I want you to put it up here, and now I want you to call on your God. This is Elijah. Call it on the God. And he didn't say that. I'm going to take a bowl. I'm going to put it up. I'm going to build an altar. We're going to do this. We have two altars here, right? One for Elijah and one for the idol Baal, right? 450 of them start calling out to their God, saying, hey, man, God, show up, blah, blah, blah. And he's not doing it. It's getting about noon, okay? And Elijah starts taunting them. Hey, man, maybe you should speak a little bit louder. He's probably sleeping. Maybe he took a walk. Or maybe he's cooking dinner, right? If you have the American Standard Version, I think it is, it says in there, he says, maybe your God is on the toilet. It says, okay, check it out, right? And so, I know, I did my research. Okay, so here they are. Now, they're getting upset. So now they're cutting themselves with spears and stuff. They're bleeding all over the place. They're dancing around this. I'm a maniac, maniac. Right? They're just doing blood flying everywhere. God, imagine this, picture this. 450 prophets all doing this for their God just to show up. Israel is there watching all this stuff. Elijah is there waiting for his turn. And finally says, wait, hold the phone, time out. Listen, man, here's what I want you to do. I want you to dig a trench around my altar. Let's just dig a trench. Make it good. Okay? And we're going to, I want it to be able to hold 4 gallons of water. Okay? That's what I want. He says, now go and grab some jugs of water and pour water all over my altar. Okay? Don't do it. So they do it. They're really doing it. And they're pouring. Right? So it's filling up the trench. It's going down the stream. Kids are playing in the mud. This is what's happening. Okay? Right? I made that last part up. Okay? So check this out. Right? So here comes Elijah. After they started crying out to God and cutting themselves and dancing and being nuts, listen to what he says. Now, at the time for offering the evening sacrifice, the prophet Elijah approached the altar and said this. He said, Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, today let it be known that you are God in Israel and I am your servant. And at your word, I have done all these things. Answer me, Lord. Answer me so that this people will know that you, the Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back. Then the Lord's fire fell and consumed the burnt offering, the wood, the stones, the dust, and it licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell face down and said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. The Lord showed up and the Lord showed off. And he is the same God now that he is back then. So when we pray, we need to pray for him to, we need to pray expectantly for him to show up and for him to show off. That's how we need to be praying. You need to be praying expectantly. Now listen, let me tell you something. God also says no. Because when my father died, we went after him. When the doctor said, Jason, he's only got this amount of percentage left to live, we had two other pastors by my, and including myself, at my dad's bedside, my brother and other family members, laying hands on my dad, going after him, just praying. I remember my brother saying, Lord, my dad just got off on the wrong floor, send him back down. Right, we're praying all over, laying hands heavily on my dad, expecting for his healing to happen. Now remember, I don't know how long it was, I was exhausted afterwards. Right? And so I go into the waiting room and I sit in this chair and I put my head back. And instantly when I put my head back, the Lord said, Jason, I'm bringing him home today. It's not what I wanted. So I got right back up and I went back into the room and I whispered in my dad's ear and I said, Dad, you can go. I'll take care of everything here. Because I'm the oldest, it's my responsibility. That's how I felt. And then about 2-3 hours later, my dad went to heaven. It's okay when God says no. Turn to your neighbor and say, a praying church is a powerful church.
Praying church is a powerful church.
All right, so Peter's free, okay? Peter's free. Check this out. Let's look it up on the screen. So when Peter came to himself, he says, now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's grasp and from all the Jewish people that the Jewish people expected. As soon as he realizes he's free, you know what? He starts to panic. I'm a wanted man. Okay? So he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John Mark, where many had assembled and were praying. He shows up where the church is praying. I'm going to go where I'm safe. Right? He knocked on the door of the outer gate. Right? So there's a gate right before you go into the house. It's like you walk into the yard. So he's knocking on the outer gate. And not too loud because he doesn't want to draw attention to himself. Right? So he's knocking on the gate. And Rhoda, the servant named Rhoda, she comes to answer the gate, right? So he's like, hey, it's me, it's Peter. There's like 30 dudes after me, right? It should be, right? And so she recognizes his voice, and because she's so overjoyed, she's like, oh my gosh, it's Peter! Right? And so she doesn't open the gate. Peter, I totally know it's you, I can smell your cologne. She runs back in the house and leaves him outside. He's like, no. Come back. Right? And she runs and she says, hey, Peter is standing at the outer gate. Right? And they're all like, girl, you're out of your mind. You're nuts. They didn't believe her, right? So But he kept insisting, no, 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 he's out there. Meanwhile, he's like this. And so they said, it's just this angel. But Peter, you know, kept knocking. And when they opened the door, they saw him. And they were amazed. They're like, girl, you're out of your mind. But sure enough, there he is knocking on the door. So here's my question, right? So they open the door, and there he is, and he's amazing. My question is why did they respond this way? My thing is when Rhoda says, he's at the gate, she's like, you're nuts. You're out of your mind. No, I'm telling you, he's there. And they're like, no. And I don't know. It says that they insisted. She kept insisting. How long was he waiting at the gate? Right? How long are you waiting? He said, come on. I'm going to the neighbors. Right? So I don't know. So here's the thing. Then they go up to the gate. They see him. And here's the other question. Why are they amazed? Why were they amazed? Shouldn't they have been expecting Peter? Listen, they were praying for this exact moment. They should have ran to the gate as soon as Rhoda said, he's at the gate. When we pray, God is always listening. Just because he doesn't say anything doesn't mean he isn't listening, because he's always listening. I guarantee you, he is already working on your behalf, and you may not even see it. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, let's talk about our country. Here's what it says. It says, and my people who bear my name humble themselves, pray, and seek my face, and turn from their evil ways, then I will what?
Hear
from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. My eyes will now be open, and my ears attentive to the prayer from this place. We have been praying for our country for a very long time. We've been asking God to step in and intervene. We've been asking God to forgive us for the things that we have done. Right? Let's just face it. We are not doing the things of the Lord right now. We are not. We have turned our back on it. We're saying, God, forgive us for that. Right? And so here we are, and we're praying. The church is praying. At least I hope the church is praying fervently on behalf of our country. Right? I'm going to tell you this. Anybody who attacks Israel, shame on you. I'm going to say that right now. You should probably not do that.
Yeah.
Because the Lord is going to come and get you. Okay? So we need to be praying for that. Listen, I was just talking to Pastor Mark today. He works at the Walmart distribution center. He said that he's been pulling 14-hour shifts, right? Because the Walmart trucks are being actually sent out to North Carolina and Georgia and all those places to help them with the needs. He said that this week they sent 26 semi-trucks just full of water out to North Carolina, right? Listen, yeah, absolutely, okay? Listen, that's how the church, the country rallies around each other. Listen, when the church prays together, it will move mountains. The Bible tells us in Matthew 18, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. Matthew 17, 20 says, because of your little faith, you told them, for truly I tell you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will tell this mountain to move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Listen, when we pray, God is listening, and mountains are moving, and we should be praying with expectations of being set free from our guarded, chained up situations. So my question is this, is who can sleep comfortably in their stormy situations? It is those who trust in the Lord to get them out. So start the conversation today, if you haven't yet, and say, Heavenly Father, I know that you see me. I know that you know my situation. And Father, I'm asking you, I can't find a way out. I'm double chained. I'm surrounded by 30 dudes. I just need you to show me how to get out. And Father, I need you to give it to me and show me and guide me. And don't stop praying. No, Lord, you ain't up. No, Jesus, you ain't up. Right? And having those conversations, right? Don't stop praying. If you've never engaged in prayer, prayer is, you need to do it now. And it's as simple as talking on the phone. How many of you here have talked on the phone sometime this week? Those of you who don't have your hands up, you're lying. Okay? So I know you've had your phone. Everybody's had it. You've talked on the phone. It's as easy as that. And listen, you don't have to rehearse anything. You can talk like you're talking, like I talked to Trudy. Right? Heavenly Father, this is what's going on. This is my heart. This is me. Right? And you just pour it out and you say, Father, I need you. I was reading this book called When God Builds a Church by Bob Russell. I was reading this book, and he tells a story of a time when he is walking in to church. Now, this is a church out in Louisville, Kentucky. This church runs about 30,000 people on a weekend, okay? And he's got so many services, all right? It's an amazing book. Go read it. So he tells a story of a time when he's walking into the sanctuary. And as he's walking into the sanctuary, there's a group of people who are walking in. And they're like, hey, Pastor, I just want to ask, how does your church run like this? People giving their life to Jesus and it's just growing. What's the deal? What's the story behind it? And he says this. He says, well, listen, it's the boiler room. It's what makes this church go. Yep. And they're like, a boiler room? And he's like, yeah. He goes, you guys want to go see the boiler room? Yes. And they had time. They're like, sure. So he goes and he takes him down to this room. And as he opens the room, he opens the door quietly because he doesn't want to disturb the boiler room. And inside the boiler room are 300 people praying for the service on that day, right? And so he says, that's what makes the church move. That's what makes the church go. Listen to me. Monday nights, every first Monday of the month, Living Water gathers and we pray. And this summer, I've been encouraging you to go out and pray in your neighborhood. Don't show up at my house. I want you to go out and pray in your neighborhood expectantly, right? Move. Now, I went out and I joined the FCA guy. He's not new, but he's been here for a while. And I joined him and we went praying around the schools. And we were praying out at South High. As we were standing at the front of the doors and we're just praying, I'm with some other pastors and I'm just praying with him. The principal of South High comes out. And she says to us, she says, listen, I noticed that you guys were praying. And she says, I want you to know that I'm a Christian too. And she says, so if there's anything that you want, post it up, you let me know and I'll make sure these things get out there. Whew. Talk about favor, right? And so I asked you guys to go out there. And now, because it's getting chilly, I'm encouraging you to come and join Trudy and I tomorrow. It'll be at my house from 6 o'clock to 7. And I'm just asking you to come, and we're just going to pray whatever Holy Spirit wants. And it's just for an hour, so you can come when you can, and you can leave when you have to, no big deal. But when we pray, we have seen God answer prayers. We have seen healings happen. We have actually seen sinners be set free. And listen, what happens here on Sunday is birthed through prayer on Monday. So you have been prayed over, and you have been prayed for. And I'm believing that God is going to be moving mountains on behalf of you and behalf of this church. I believe that God is already moving mountains right now. I believe in the power of prayer. I do not do anything unless I go to the Lord first. And I'm telling you, when I have a conversation with the Lord, I know you hang up. I was on my prayer walk this week. And when I got out to the part where I start praying, all the Lord says, Jason, all I want you to do is listen. I said, okay. Man, I love it when he talks. I love it when he shows off. I love it when he shows up. It's amazing. And I was coming to the end of my prayer walk, and the Lord kind of started to go silent. And I was like, no, don't you hang up on me. I want more. And he says, that's all I have for you today. It's okay. Strike up that conversation. Because here's what I believe. I believe that a praying church is a powerful church. Yes, sir. And so, Heavenly Father, I come to you right now, and I just thank you. I thank you for what you're doing in our lives. I thank you for the story of Peter and how you set him free. Father, and I'm praying right now, in this moment, in our midst, Father, that you would just come right now. And I pray, Lord, that you would break every chain that is in this room. I pray, God, that nobody would be tied down to these situations. Father, that you would intervene, that you would step in, and that you would move. I pray, God, that you would encourage those who need encouragement. Father, I pray, God, that you would show those folks who feel like they are unforgivable that they are forgiven. Father, for those who have walked in this room and feel like they aren't loved, God, that they are loved. Father, I pray, God, for those who need your grace and your mercy. Father, I pray, God, for those who need a healing in whatever illness or disease they're battling. And you are the same God back then in the Bible that you are right now. I pray, Father, that you would speak only the words that we know that you need, that we need. Father, I pray, God, that you remove our doubt in who we think you are. God, if we are doubting you, Father, remove that. And so with every head bowed and every eye closed, all I want you to do is take a minute. And all I want you to do is get real with the Lord. No distractions. You're not worried about what's next. You're not worried about what's lunch. You're not worried about your football team. You're worried about your relationship with Jesus. And you're saying, Father, I need you. I want you. And I'm going to ask you to be brave. And I'm going to ask you to be bold. And I'm going to ask you that you'd ask God to step into the places that you need him desperately. Whatever it is. Get real with him right now. Have that conversation. This is like talking on the phone. Some of you are probably saying, Father, Lord, I haven't talked to you in a while. Lord, this is the first time I've ever done it. That's okay, do it. Maybe some of you are struggling with something in your life or someone in your life. Bring it to the table. Maybe you're struggling with who you are. You don't like who you are. Say, Father, show me. Break that mold of me. Because I want to walk in the newness of you. I want to be transformed by you. Build me from the inside out. That's what I want. That's what I need. Come your way. Just a couple more seconds. Just get real with it. Father, I know I need some correction right here. Correct that. Maybe some of you are sitting in this room right now and you've never asked Jesus to be the Lord and Savior. Maybe some of you have, but you didn't mean it. You're just going through the motions, but now you know. Holy Spirit, just come and have your way. I don't know what's going on, but I do know today that your breakthrough is today. Chains are falling today. Do you believe? Do you trust? Are you praying expectantly? I believe in the power of prayer. So, Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you just come and have your way. Holy Spirit, consume us. Set the captives free. Father, set the sinners free. Father, I pray, God, for repentance in this room. Father, that we would come and repent of our sins and walk in the path that you have laid out for us. Father, that some of us are in this room are saying, Father, I believe. Jesus, be the Lord and Savior of my life. I know I'm a sinner. And I ask that you come and consume me and take over. Come and have your way in me. Come have your way in my life. Change my life. Change my family's life. Change my children's life. Change my situation. I surrender. Because your word says that if I believe in my heart, and confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. And I believe that you have raised Jesus from the dead, I will be saved. So come have your way in me. Holy Spirit, just consume us right now. And we just love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. The name that is above every name. The name that has freedom in it. In Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to stand and sing this song called I Believe. And I want you to stand as if you're in the presence of the throne room of God. I want you to sing like you're singing to him. But if you've never given your life to Jesus, and you know that today's that day, I want you to be brave, and I want you to come forward and grab our hands. We want to pray with you, Lord. Maybe you just need some prayer with something that's going on in your life. Or maybe you and your family need to come and kneel at the altar. I don't know. But today is the day of breakthrough. Today is the day where God is moving in your life. I believe that. I believe that when I started putting this together. I believe that many of you are going to have your breakthrough today. I believe that many of you are going to have a healing today. I believe that. I pray expectantly. Because I believe in what our God says he can do. Because our God is still a miracle working God. Believe that. So sing this out. If you need prayer or whatever, come. Come grab our hands. We want to pray with you. Will you come? Let's sing it out. Let's pray. From the
beginning, you've been a changing. Age to age, you stay. Constant, you remain. Every mystery, the questions I carry are safe within your will. So I trust you even still. You've already made it.
Father, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we ask that you be with us this week. Help what you gave us today and what you spoke to us, Lord, doesn't just stay in this room, Lord, but we take it out and we just change our community. We love you, Jesus, in your name. Amen. See you tomorrow night.